Thanks very much, Greg. And good afternoon, everyone. Good to be here today. Thanks very much for coming as well. Just a quick introduction off the back of what Greg said. I'm Richard. I'm a project director here at Jellyfish. I've been with the company for just over 3 years, but I've been working in the field of design for about 20 years. My job here really is to help kind of pull the different service offerings together, you know, with a view to delivering benefits to our clients. And a large part of that is web design and development, and that's probably, you know, forms a large part of my day-to-day. Of late, there's been a lot of talk about a topic called responsive design, which you may or may not have heard of, based in large part to a blog post that went up onto the Google Webmaster Central blog back at the beginning of June, entitled Recommendations for Building Smartphone Optimized Websites. We know the mobile internet is big, so, you know, currently roughly 60% of all mobile phones feature a full HTML browser as part of their feature set. 36% of the population owning a smartphone, and anecdotally I think I heard that the rate of growth in mobile is something like 8 times that of desktop currently, so, you know, we know it's huge. And interestingly, mobile has its own particular personality. The small screen size, the different interactions, for the fact that, you know, you're using a touchscreen device, for example, and wider access to the internet, so you're no longer restricted to access through your home or work broadband connection, for instance. But if you cast your mind back to around sort of 2005, 2006, the experience was dreadful. These devices, great bit of product design on the outside, dreadful bit of product design on the inside. The experience of using the internet was slow, unintuitive, just incredibly frustrating. And then in 2007, this device arrived, the iPhone, and it was one of the first devices to feature a fully enabled internet browser as part of the feature set, followed by an absolute proliferation of mobile devices, tablet devices. So, you know, we know that that marketplace has grown astonishingly quickly. It obviously started with the desktop, so the whole idea of the internet was to connect these desktop devices to give us faster access to information and a better flow of communication. And now, with the growth of mobile, you know, we've seen the success of the desktop, but the way that people are interacting with the internet is starting to change, and it's becoming very, very much focused around the devices that you carry with you on a daily basis. So maybe we need to start thinking about mobile first. So what's mobile first? A few of you may have seen this guy talk, Luke Robolowski. He's an American web designer, user experience expert, and he talks extensively about his beliefs and his experience designing for or designing user experiences for mobile and other channels. Luke kind of summarizes this idea of mobile first as a philosophy quite eloquently. That mobile is very much about growth. So yes, we know it's big and we know there's a massive change in user behavior. That represents a huge opportunity for businesses. The nature of the device is different in that it's constrained. Like the small form factor, even in itself, forces you very much to focus on the key elements of functionality that you wish to deliver to the user. And the capability set is a bit different. So, you know, there's a greater feature set. The fact that you're not just interacting with a mouse, you're interacting with your finger, your voice, using things like GPS navigation, the phone sensing the orientation of the screen. You know, there are lots of different features and capabilities that are starting to come through this this new device. So why is that a good thing? Well, this idea of mobile first is that, by its very essence, having to go through the process of analysing very, very carefully what it is that you're trying to achieve within the mobile space, where you're working with a very small form factor, where you're working with potentially a much reduced attention span, it forces you to really focus and be quite ruthless, actually, in deciding what elements of functionality and usability you're going to deliver. So if you've already gone through that discussion internally with your various stakeholders and you've managed to strip away lots of the noise that may exist on your existing desktop site to get to this essence, then surely you've created a better user experience. So perhaps it might be worth then looking at testing that reduced feature set in a desktop space. You've already had the discussions. You've already agreed in principle this is something that we're interested in pursuing. So the idea is perhaps that then you look to deliver a more simplified and more focused user experience at the desktop level. So it's a really interesting philosophy, and I think it's one that, you know, that a lot of businesses are starting to think this way. How does that relate to responsive design? Well, I guess you need to understand what responsive design is. And it's a web design and development methodology that's really been pioneered by this guy, a chap by the name of Ethan Marco, again, who's a US web designer, speaker, and author, and he's written some pretty good books that we use very extensively within the field of web design and development. He cites his inspiration behind responsive design, partly coming from the idea of responsive architecture, the methodology or the movement that a building can adapt its environment to accommodate the user. So, for instance, in this building, we've got sensors in the ceiling, very simple, but these monitor when there are people in the rooms and turn the lights on and off accordingly, so that when we're here, we have illumination. When it's not needed, it goes off. It's a simple idea. And it's slightly at odds with the way that the mobile or the internet works across multiple devices. So I guess the old or arguably the current approach to mobile and serving of content to different devices is that you create a different page of HTML that's optimized for desktop, potentially one for tablet, more than likely one for mobile. Why does it work that way? Well, the whole world of web design started very much with very similar principles to that which we use in the world of graphic design for print. The idea that when you're faced with a design challenge, one of the first things you think about is the canvas that you're going to be using. So whether that's an A4 piece of paper or a postcard is going to dictate what kind of design solution you apply and potentially what kind of content solution you look to deliver. But the web's way more dynamic than that. If you think about how you use your desktop browser on a daily basis, it's very unlikely that you're going to be using a fixed width or fixed proportion browser window throughout the whole of your browsing experience or your whole of your browsing life. It varies very much. And when you start taking that or carrying that thought through to more mobile-enabled devices, like the smartphones and tablets, the variables become even more wide. So I think, for instance, currently, Android devices have over 500 different standard viewport pixel dimension sizes. So there is no standard, really. So you start thinking, well, why are we designing and delivering mobile sites that are optimized for a 320 by 420 pixel view? It kind of seems a little bit at odds with the way that people are going to be using the internet. And if you think about the additional number of devices that are going to be coming on stream over the course of the next couple of years, as web designers, we've got no way of really forecasting that and trying to, it's just not efficient to deliver so many multiple solutions at such a granular level. But thankfully, there is a solution. And it's something that's kind of started to come to the fore within the last couple of years. I'm just going to duck out of this presentation for a moment and take you to the Jellyfish website, which I think you guys might have seen earlier. We employ this idea of responsive design ourselves. And so the idea is that this site automatically is sensing the browser through which it's being presented and the screen proportions through which the browser window is sized. So as the browser window changes, so the design solution that we're delivering starts to adapt to react to the different sizes. So when you get down, for instance, to a narrow browser window like this, which is the kind of solution we deliver to someone using a mobile device, you see that we've changed the navigation. So we've created something that's much easier to use as a touchscreen device. We've changed the format and the spacing of the navigation to make that easier to use. You compare that back to the desktop version. It's the same page, it's just using styles to present different information in different context. So, how does responsive design work? I guess this is just a quick little delve into the kind of the technical way of approaching this. Fundamentally, we draw upon a thing called media queries, which is it's an element of functionality that was enabled within HTML and CSS3. So it's basically a bit of code that enables us to communicate to the browser, understand a certain set of characteristics for that particular browser window, and then serve different code dependent upon that scenario. We use fluid grids, and we'll come on to explain this in a little bit more. The idea of fluid grid, it's the opposite to a traditional design for print grid where you would be working in fixed measurements and even in fixed pixel measurements. We don't do that. We work based around proportions. So we try and find the ideal proportion for a particular layout, and then we can scale that accordingly. And then flexible images. So obviously if the size and width of the page is changing and the elements on that page need to change as well, we need a way of dynamically doing that. And there's simple coding tricks that we can do to deliver that. We can also add an additional layer. So if you think, like, you look at two iPhones, like the iPhone 3 and the iPhone 4, it's not, like, the screen size physically is very similar, but the resolution has changed. So with the introduction of the Retina display, it's added an extra little layer of complexity to this, so that we're now dealing with, like, 250 pixels per inch as opposed to, like, 125, I think. So we can use this responsive solution to find out what kind of device, what the resolution is, and serve a different image so you get the right quality at the right point in the process. So yeah, media queries, very, very simple. It's supported by CSS3, and it's something that would be well within the skill set of any web design and development agency worth their salt. Fluid grids is a principle. There's lots and lots of information about this online that, that I'm sure, you know, you can take away and interrogate, but it's a very simple principle. Moving from fixed to basically proportional is the key change there, and flexible images. Good thing as well, it's a front-end technology. So what does that mean? All of this happens within the browser window. So the theory, and obviously this is going to be case by case because everybody's website is different and it's built differently, the theory states that you should be able to add in a layer of responsive design and this solution in front of your e-commerce platform or in front of your CMS without too much re-engineering. You don't generally need to look at this as a ground-up rebuild, so you know it can be quite cost-effective. And it also enables us to do some pretty cool things, as I showed earlier. We can tailor usability for different screen sizes to accommodate, you know, use by a finger rather than a mouse pointer. We can start to remove noise from a busy page. So as the page starts to scale down, we've removed some elements here. We remove the image from the mobile device, just focusing on the key elements that you want to deliver within that particular user experience. And another great thing is, because we're able to control all of the style for each different presentation, we can optimize at different levels. So we can undertake, say, for conversion optimization, we can do that for a desktop and for a tablet and for a mobile, just by isolating the changes we make within relevant style sheets. Obviously, you know, you need to put a plan together to do this, but it's all possible. So why is it a hot topic right now? Well, back in like 2006, a lady by the name of Barbara Ballen, I think it was, kind of summarized this argument that was starting to rage between the idea of one web and multiple web, or the mobile web, where you have a different solution. And she summarized it, I think, pretty well, that you know, the argument for one web is that, you know, the internet is the internet and it should work well for all devices, independent of how you're accessing that. And there's basically going to be one page of it content, and optimization for that is based on CSS and device detection, which is what we've been talking about, versus the mobile web, which is really kind of how a lot of this has been delivered over the last couple of years, the idea of like the m.mobile site or .mobi, having a dedicated site that's optimized separately. Why is it a hot topic? Well, over the last couple of months, there's been a couple of big changes. On June the 6th, Google went on record saying that their preference is to deliver the smartphone solution via a responsive design. So these guys are on board. Bing saying exactly the same thing. They totally advocate the idea of the one URL per content item and then delivering a dynamic design solution to accommodate that. The benefits, you'll have more ranking signals coming to that one URL. People have less tendency to link to mobile versions of a site than they do to a desktop site as well, which is quite interesting. For those of you with large sites, which I reckon is probably, you know, quite a few of you here, you're going to experience less search engine crawler traffic coming to those sites and obviously the overhead that brings. And it's less work. You've only got to manage and maintain one site rather than multiple variants, which is has got to be a good thing. Also, media queries are really key to the success of this whole idea of responsive design. And that's a bit of functionality that is now supported across the board with all of the current versions of the major mobile browsers at desktop and mobile level. For previous versions of things like IE, sort of 8 and before, doesn't support media queries, but that's not a problem because we have techniques that enable us to patch the functionality of the browser dynamically within a session and facilitate this. So we can make it work pretty much all the way back to IE6. There or thereabouts. It's not too much of a problem. So we think there's some pretty compelling benefits as to why you should be using this, or at least starting some conversations. It's what the search engines want you to do. They've gone on record and said that. And obviously, you know, they have a lot of control over the landscape, so that's worth listening to. Maintaining one site is less time consuming and therefore cheaper, and potentially enables you to get solutions to market quicker, which is always a good thing. combining this with that idea of mobile first, it enables you to create user experiences that are greatly improved over perhaps what you'd see in the desktop. And it's a really great way to focus on performance. And I guess there's an opportunity to get it right now. It's something you can do pretty quickly. It's not a major re-engineering of your site. And I guess thanks to the recent developments over the last couple of weeks, it's probably something your competitors are going to be talking about. So it's just a matter of time. So I just wanted to close by thanking all of you for listening. Just a quick little presentation, I guess, just as a kind of primer to this whole idea of responsive design. There's some great resources. Luke Robolowski and Ethan Marcotte talk about this extensively online, and there's a couple of good videos, which I admit I've borrowed quite heavily from, because what they say is, I believe, you know, very, very strong. Links to the Google and Bing announcements, and also a couple of books about the subject. So I hope you found that interesting, and thank you very much for your time.